there is one king whose power has never faded and whose kingdom will never end. And that king, of course, is Jesus.
God established his covenant with David in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 8 through 16. This covenant established David's descendants as Israel's permanent dynasty. God demonstrated great benevolence to David and to Israel by ensuring that David's descendants would reign and that Israel would enjoy the stability of dynastic succession.
Because of David's obedience and devotion to God, he promised that Israel's kingship would be perpetually traced through David's line. No person could ever legitimately claim to be king in Israel unless he was from David's house.
The Old Testament established many expectations for future kings, and especially for the one special messianic king that was prophesied to fulfill God's goal of establishing his kingdom on earth. The New Testament clearly teaches that Jesus is the Davidic king promised in the Old Testament. For example, the Magi described him as the king of the Jews in Matthew chapter 2, verse 2. Jesus' disciples attributed royal titles such as Messiah or Christ to him in places like Mark chapter 8, verses 27 through 29. He was called the King of Israel in John chapter 1, verse 49. And most importantly, just before his death, Jesus himself claimed to be the messianic king promised by the Old Testament.
It's important to stress that Jesus is faithful to the covenant to be the very basis for his right to rule over us. He could not be the one who is given to be King of Kings and Lord of Lords in that messianic work, in that kingly work, without his full obedience and faithfulness unto the Father.
Jesus fulfills the law in his continual faithfulness to covenant-keeping, law-abiding behavior, so that he becomes our righteousness. The Bible says that God is both just and the justifier. And so he comes with his law, and then he comes with his Son, keeping the law for us. So he both is the just one and the one who justifies us in Christ.
As the heir to David's throne, Jesus began to fulfill God's kingdom purposes first by restoring a faithful remnant within national Israel, namely his faithful apostles and disciples. Then, as Jesus commanded in Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20, these followers expanded their ranks by evangelizing and discipling both Jews and Gentiles in every nation they could reach. When Jesus returns, the entire new earth will be part of his kingdom, and his physical power and rule will replace all earthly governments. For now, his universal reign is primarily spiritual, as we see in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 21 and 22. But when he returns, it will also be physical. Revelation chapters 21 and 22 paint a glorious picture of the new heavens and earth, where Jesus reigns as king from his capital in the New Jerusalem. But what does this goal mean for us? How should modern Christians respond to the idea that Jesus' goal is to turn the entire world into God's kingdom? Well, the simple answer is that we should make God's kingdom the main goal for our lives too. Whatever other goals we have, making a living, providing for our families, staying healthy, getting an education, they should all be pursued in ways that further the kingdom of God.